asking, do you love me more than these other disciples do? After all, you once told me you do. And then you didn't. And it's interesting that there were three times that Jesus was denied by Peter. And there's three times he's given Peter the chance to give the right answer. He gave the wrong answer three times when people said, do you love Jesus? Are you one of his disciples? Do you love Jesus? No. Do you love Jesus? No. Do you love Jesus? No, I don't even know the man. He had said three times. And now Jesus comes back to him and says, well, do you love me? And he affirmed all three times that he loved him, although it may possibly be that Peter was not able to bring himself to say, I agape you, knowing that he had once professed that kind of love for Jesus and then proven that he didn't have it after all. So maybe he was ashamed to use the word agape in responding, or a similar word in Aramaic. So that might be the reason why there are different Greek words used here, that Jesus was pressing for, do you agape me? You said you do. You said you'd die for me. You said you love me more than these others do. Do you agape me more than they do? And Peter was ashamed, of course, and could only say, well, I'm fond of you. You know, I love you, but maybe not like I should. And Jesus asked twice agape and only got the same answer. So Jesus says, well, do you phileo me? Do you love me in any sense? And Peter, despite his inability to use the word agape, did affirm that he loved Jesus, and most scholars agree that this was Jesus giving him the opportunity to recover from his three denials. Because on an earlier occasion in the life of Jesus, recorded in the 10th chapter of Matthew, Jesus said, whoever denies me before men, I will deny him before my Father in heaven. And whoever confesses me before men, I will confess him before my Father in heaven. Peter had denied Jesus before men. In a sense, he stood condemned as one whom Jesus should deny before the Father and therefore disown. Peter had disowned Jesus. Jesus then should disown him. But Jesus seems to be giving him a chance to, as it were, redeem himself, to get it right this time. Let's go through that again. Wouldn't it be nice if we could just go through some of those times again, that when we look back and say where we did the wrong thing and think, boy, I wish I could just kind of set the clock back to before that happened and do it differently this time. Unfortunately, we don't have that opportunity very often. But it's like Jesus is doing essentially the same thing. He said, let's set the calendar back a few days here. Three times you were asked if you love me and you gave the wrong answer. Let's try that again. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And he did give a right answer. At least he owned Jesus. He said he loved Jesus, and he got it right. And each time, Jesus said, well, then feed my sheep, or feed my lambs, or tend my sheep, tend my lambs. In other words, he commissioned him to be a shepherd of God's people. Now, when he had first called him, he called him to be a fisher of men, which is evangelistic work. And now, adding to that duty, no doubt, is the shepherding, pastoral work of tending the church. Not just evangelizing the lost and bringing fish in, but also taking care of the flock. Peter, as an apostle, had both the evangelistic and pastoral duties that all the apostles did. The Roman Catholics, of course, used this scripture to say that Jesus was making Peter the chief of the apostles, that the other apostles were the sheep, and he was made the shepherd. And that Jesus was telling Peter, tend my sheep or feed my sheep. In other words, you be the overseer of all the other apostles. And so the Roman Catholics believed that Peter was the chief of the apostles. And that's important to them because they believe that the popes in any generation are the successors to Peter, and therefore the chief of all the bishops of the churches. But this is reading certainly more into this than is necessary. After all, Peter himself wrote to lesser leaders in the churches. In 1 Peter chapter 5, he wrote to the elders of the churches. Now, every church had, or most of the churches had elders. These were just the local officials. They didn't have the rank of apostles. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, Verse 1, Peter says, the elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also the partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. He says then, shepherd the flock of God, which is among you, serving as overseers. And he goes on and explains how that is to be done. But notice, Peter himself gives the same commission to the elders of the churches as Jesus gave to him. If Jesus' statements to Peter amount to placing him above all the other apostles, then would not the same words spoken to the elders amount to putting them above all the apostles? I mean, how is it that it would mean that in one case and not in the other? It seems clear that Peter is saying, I too am an elder. You are elders, and I'm an elder. Now, I also happen to be an apostle, but it is in the capacity of an elder that we have this duty to shepherd the sheep. All elders must shepherd the flock. Peter has to do so too, because he is also an elder. He's also a leader. He's a very special leader in that he belongs to the apostolic company, but he sees himself and his fellow elders, as he puts it. He says, I'm also a fellow elder. They're all Christian leaders are supposed to shepherd the flock. Therefore, Peter did not indicate that he was the unique shepherd of the flock. Jesus is that. In fact, Peter even says that in the same passage. Because he says in verse 4, 1 Peter 5:4, and when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of glory that does not fade away. So the elders and Peter are shepherds, but there is a chief shepherd, and he's not talking about himself. Peter's not the chief shepherd. Jesus is the chief shepherd. All the others are just shepherds, including Peter. So when Jesus says to Peter, feed or tend my sheep or my lambs, there's no reason to think that he's saying anything more to Peter than what Peter says to the elders in 1 Peter 5, verse 2. There is a chief shepherd, but it isn't Peter, and Jesus is not making him a chief shepherd. He's just making him a shepherd. He's simply restoring him to the position that he and the other apostles had before, in which the other apostles did not forfeit, but he did. By denying Christ, he essentially was like Judas. He had defected. But Jesus restored him and recommissioned him and gave him authority with the other apostles to, and with all Christian leaders, to shepherd the flock instead of just disowning him as Peter had disowned Jesus. Then he makes this little prophetic statement to Peter, verse 18, most assuredly I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wished. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. It says, this he spoke, signifying by what death Peter would glorify God. And when he had so spoken this, he said to him, follow me. Now, the tradition of the church is that Peter glorified God in his death by being crucified. In fact, the story is told in some of the ancient writings, whether reliably or not, no one knows, that Peter was actually crucified upside down. As the story goes, he was condemned by Nero to be crucified as Jesus was, and Peter did not believe himself worthy to die in the manner that Jesus did and thought he should die worse. And so Peter himself requested that he be crucified upside down. And his request was granted. This story about Peter being crucified upside down is often retold, but it's really found in an apocryphal gospel. I think it's called the Acts of Peter, or the Gospel of Peter. There's an apocryphal gospel from which that story comes. And most of the things in the gospel are not reliable. Therefore, that story may not be either. However, it is no doubt reliable that Peter did die crucified, whether upside down or right side up, we don't know. And John, writing no doubt after Peter had died, and knowing how Peter had died, recognized in these sayings of Jesus to him a prediction of how Peter would die. You know, there's the statement Jesus made to Peter is vague. If you did not have other information about how Peter died, you wouldn't see any obvious prediction of crucifixion here necessarily. True, he says you will stretch out your hands, but he doesn't say which direction. You might stretch out your hands to have handcuffs put on you or to be bound. He says, people will bind you, they will gird you, they'll take you where you don't want to go. It doesn't say anything specific about crucifixion, but the wording was such ambiguous enough that once John, knowing the facts of how Peter had died, could, you know, look back and say, well, that's really alluded to by what Jesus said to him. In any case, what Jesus is saying to him is, you were a man at your own liberty when you were younger. You chose your own profession. You had your own business. You worked when you wanted to work. You went where you wanted to go. But that's not the case anymore. As my disciple, you are not at your own liberty. You are now going to be subject to other people's will, including those who will persecute you, including those who will take you where you don't want to go. And so this was not, in any case, even if Peter didn't recognize this as a specific statement about his martyrdom, though John later recognized it as such, whether Peter did or not, he saw it was kind of undesirable. It's kind of negative to have someone bind you and gird you and take you where you don't want to go. So Jesus has given him sort of a negative, somewhat of a pessimistic view of how things may end up for Peter. But he said, nonetheless, follow me. And then Peter, turning around, saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following. Which was, it tells us that disciple is one who also had leaned on his breast at the supper and said, Lord, who is it who will betray you? That was, I think, the first time maybe it wasn't the first time, but it was one of the early times when we were introduced to John by this title, the disciple whom Jesus loved. And so we're told that this is that same disciple. Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, but Lord, what about this man? Now, Jesus had just made a prediction about Peter's future that was not, what should we say, not pleasant, not encouraging. Peter was going to have, he was going to be at the mercy of others who would do things to him and take him places where he didn't want to go. This is not sounding good. What about John? Is that going to happen to him too? Now, Peter and John were very close. We find that they were apparently living together in Jerusalem when Mary Magdalene came and brought the report. They also were apparently the two disciples who earlier had gone and got the donkey for Jesus to ride into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. They also, of course, were two of the three that we usually call the inner circle, Peter, James, and John, and they were on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus when the others were not. They were in the house of Jairus when he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead when the others were not. They were the ones that Jesus took with him into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray with him while the others were left at the gate. Peter, James, and John, as a group, were specially privileged to do some things and see some things with Jesus that others were not. But James is not included in some of the things where Peter and John act together, including them being the first males to appear at the tomb of Jesus after the resurrection. Furthermore, in the book of Acts, we see them still acting together. It is they together who are entering the temple in Acts 3 and cure the man who is lame. And they got arrested together, Peter and John. Likewise, apparently, in later stories in Acts, the two seem to be partners. And so Peter and John have this partnership. And Peter's been told that bad things are going to happen to him. Undesirable things are going to happen to him. And he wonders, is John, you know, is my partner? Is that going to happen to him too? Just curious. You know, he may be implying, am I going to have it worse than him? If so, is that really fair? You know, is he going to have to suffer as much as I'm going to have to suffer? There may have been a little of that in the question. But Jesus' answer was, if I will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. Jesus gives each person his own commission. God has for each one their own destiny, their own lot, their own cross to bear. And we will find at times there are others who seem to have it easier than we do. My parents' lives are not over yet, so I don't know how much they may suffer in their old age. But they have lived very peaceful lives. They've had a very happy marriage, a very easy marriage compared to most. They're very happy people. They've not been rich, but they've been comfortable. I sometimes look at their lives and think, Lord, how come my dad had a life like that, and I've had these things happen to me? And I've had things happen to me that were unpleasant. And I sometimes think, well, Lord, you know, why do I have this lot in life, and someone like my dad has such a comparatively easy lot in life, it seems to me. Now, maybe his life has had trials that are only he knows and that I don't know. I mean, maybe he hasn't had it as easy in all respects as it would appear. And for that reason, it's really foolish to compare ourselves with others and say, well, it seems like someone else has an easier life than I have. Yeah, well, if we want to make comparisons, how about compare me to Richard Wurmbrand or to Brother Yun, you know, in China, who was tortured, and I mean, these men were tortured for years. You know, if we want to make comparisons here, it's not a wise thing to do. Paul said in 2 Corinthians that certain persons he was critical of, it says, in comparing themselves with one another, they're not wise. And it's not wise to compare yourself with other people because you can't really know all that somebody else is going through. Much suffering is internal. Much burdens that we bear, probably the most significant ones, are inside us. And, you know, no one can see them. Therefore, if I have external burdens and someone else does not appear to have external burdens, it's not wise or safe for me to assume that I'm suffering more than they are. They may be suffering more than I am in ways that are not communicated to me. And they may get less sympathy than I do because no one can see what they're going through, nor sympathize with them. And people can see what I go through and they sympathize with me. Maybe I've got it easier in that way too. Maybe I'm more privileged to have external burdens than the internal ones. I don't know. Not that I don't have internal ones too. The point is, it just is a fool's errand to try to say, well, is my situation like this other person's situation? No, because I'm not like them. I have everything from my birth to my present day has been different than their life from their birth to this present day. Different circumstances of birth, different upbringing, different family, different trials, different gifts, different challenges. Everything's different. It's a foolish thing to think that everyone should have the same destiny and should have the same lot in life. Everything that each of us has is the thing that God has designed for us because it's suited to us and His purpose for us. And Peter apparently was wondering, you know, well, I've heard something about what's going to happen to me. Let's hear what's going to happen to John now. And Jesus said, that's none of your business, is it? That's just not your concern. He didn't say what would happen to John. He just said, that's not for you to be concerned about. You'd be concerned about one thing, and that's what I've told you to do. And probably one of the biggest mistakes that Christians make that make them bitter or that make them unproductive or that in some other way impede their spiritual progress or productivity is comparing themselves with others and saying, are they doing as much as I'm doing? You know, why am I asked to carry this load and this other person doesn't seem to have it? How come these people aren't helping out? How come I'm doing all the work around here? Well, that's between them and God. And what you're doing is between you and God. The question is not, is anyone else doing the same thing or as much as you're doing? The question is, are you doing what you're supposed to be doing? That's all that you need to be concerned about. Nothing else. Are you doing what God has given you to do? That's all you need to worry about. The day will come when God settles all the scores, will reward and punish and do all those things. That's not your jurisdiction. That's not your providence. That's not your... it's not for you to be even distracted by. And so he said, what if I want him to stay alive until I come? What is that to you? Now, the suggestion here is that Peter will not stay alive until Jesus comes. Basically, Jesus is saying, what if John's lot is different than yours? What if he does, in fact, survive until I come back? And you don't. Is that something you want to lodge a complaint about that? You want to protest that? Or why don't you just not think about that and just think about what I've told you is my will for you? That's what you need to be concerned about. Just follow me. You follow me and you won't have to pay attention to how well or in what circumstances others are following me. That's what he's saying to Peter. Now, the way Jesus worded that led to a misunderstanding in the early church. And John tells us about that. And no doubt, what John next tells us actually provides the reason why this chapter was added. This chapter seems to be added in order to tell us two important things that we would not have gotten without it. One is this Peter, who denied Jesus three times, which is on record, also had, by the direct action of Jesus, been restored to a shepherding role in the church. If not for the knowledge of that, there might have been many Christians in the early church who said, well, what do I care what Peter says? I don't respect him. He denied the Lord three times. And this chapter is added to help us restore our confidence that we should recognize the apostleship of Peter and respect his leadership. That would especially be important in the early generations of the church. But it is at all times, of course. But then there's this other thing. In the early church, the words that Jesus said to Peter about John came to be misunderstood and circulated in a modified form, so that people began to think that Jesus had predicted his coming would be before the death of John. That's what we read here, verse 23. Then this saying went out among the brethren that this disciple would not die. Now the writer says, yet Jesus did not say to him that he would not die, but if I will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? So he restates it exactly how Jesus said it and said, you see, there is no actual prediction here. He said, if it is my will, it's hypothetical, that he live until I come, what is that to you? The writer is saying Jesus did not predict that John would live until Jesus comes. You may know that there are people who are full preterists. They believe that all predicted scriptures have been fulfilled already usually in 70 AD. And some of them use this verse to say, see, Jesus came back in 70 AD because Jesus said John would live to see him come. Now, obviously, their use of this verse is making the very mistake that John wrote this to correct. He wrote this to say, no, he did not say that. He did not say that John would live until he comes. And obviously, John has not lived till then. I've actually had people call me on the radio and ask me, based on this, do you think John's still alive somewhere in the world today? Because Jesus hasn't come yet. Do you suppose somewhere in hiding, waiting to be revealed in the end times, that John may still be alive because Jesus said this? I think, why don't you read what it says? It does not say that John will not die.
I don't think so.
It's like, that rumor was going around, John says, and he corrects it. And yet, despite the correction, people still read it wrong and get the wrong impressions from it. I guess there's no end to the possibilities of people misunderstanding things that are made very clear. But it would appear that one reason this 21st chapter was added to John was because perhaps after the first 20 chapters had been written, and it might have been considered a complete work, it became, perhaps some short time later, clear that there were misunderstandings circulating in the church about what Jesus had said on this occasion to Peter about John. And therefore, it was thought necessary to add this chapter to kind of clear that up, to basically set the scene, set the stage of where that comment was made, what the context was, and what the actual statement was, and what it was not. And so, this clarification in verse 23 is probably giving us the reason why this whole chapter was added to the book. Then verse 24, this is the disciple who testifies of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. Now, who's we? It keeps talking about this disciple. He's been mentioned many times in the book, and he probably was mentioned as early as chapter 1. When two disciples of John the Baptist heard John speak about Jesus and followed Jesus, and one of them was Andrew, but the other was unnamed. In all likelihood, the other one was John. And we've had these many anonymous references to John, that other disciple, the disciple whom Jesus loved, and now we're talking about him again here in this chapter. And the close of the book is, this is the disciple that wrote these things and testified to these things. And we know his testimony is true. Well, who's we? It seems obvious that the book has come down to us preserved by a group of people. And most would assume that they would be the leaders of the church in Ephesus, where John spent his final years. After John was on Patmos and wrote the book of Revelation, tradition says that he was released from that imprisonment by the Emperor Nerva, and he went and spent his final years in the city of Ephesus. And in that city, you may remember hearing the story how even when he was very old and decrepit and could hardly sit up, they'd actually bring him into every church service on a pallet. And they'd say, "Brother John, do you have any word for the church?" And he'd kind of get up on one elbow and stick his other finger in the air and say, "Love one another." And then he'd collapse down and they'd take him on out again. He really didn't, he was so weak he could hardly sit up, but he would always have the same exhortation. That's how some of the church fathers have recorded the final years of John in Ephesus. And if indeed he died in Ephesus in peace, an old man, then he did die differently than Peter did, and differently from all the apostles. All the other apostles died violently as martyrs. John seems to have been the only one who died peaceably, but he didn't live to see Jesus come back. By the way, there is a tradition also about him that he was condemned to die, a martyr, and that he was dipped in boiling oil, which was a way to kill a man, obviously, but it didn't kill him. In fact, it didn't even burn him, it would seem. And because he was not burned, he was then banished to the island of Patmos instead. The story could be true. Something similar happened to one of John's own disciples, a man named Polycarp. Polycarp was a disciple of John, and he was sent to be burnt at the stake, and the fires wouldn't touch him until they killed him with a spear, and then he died, and then the fires burned his body. But he was had fires. He was put at a stake, and fires were built around him, and the fires leaped around him, but wouldn't touch his body. And this is verified by the witnesses of the church at Smyrna, where he was bishop, in the famous early document, the Martyrdom of Polycarp. So, and Polycarp was a disciple of John. It may be that John had a similar experience. He was dipped in boiling oil, and the oil wouldn't touch him, wouldn't burn him. In any case, John would be willing to be a martyr. It's not his fault if he didn't die that way. But if he died peaceably in the city of Ephesus, then it's very possible that the leaders of the church there are the ones who preserved his memoirs. He wrote them, but they collected them. Or maybe he didn't write them with his hand. He may have dictated them. After all, we say Paul wrote Romans, but he didn't write it with his own hand. A man named Tertius wrote the book of Romans, and he says so. In the greetings in the end of Romans, after Paul says, "Greet so-and-so, greet so-and-so, greet so-and-so," apparently Paul took a break, and we see this verse, "I, Tertius, who wrote this letter, also greet you." So a man named Tertius wrote the book of Romans. Paul dictated it, so he wrote it through an amanuensis. These men may be the ones who actually wrote down John's memoirs at his dictation. And they, like Tertius, adding his own name and his own greetings at the end of Romans, these men add their own endorsement, say, "Now, this disciple is the one who is the witness to these things. He's the author of this book. And we who have collected his writings, or who have taken down dictation, or we who have preserved what he said, we want to put our stamp of approval. We can say we know he's telling the truth." Now, how would they know that he's telling the truth? They weren't there to see these things happen. But what they're saying is we can give him a character reference. We know this man. We know this man is not a liar. He's an apostle, for one thing, and we know that his testimony is reliable. And so we just want to give him a character reference here so that you'll be even more inclined to believe him than you might otherwise have been. And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which, if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Now, this is the only "I" in the book. I suppose. The author who's writing it actually kind of tips his hand a little bit that he's actually there. Of course, you know that somebody's writing it, but he never mentions himself previously. We have the "we" of the previous verse. We know that his testimony is true. And if John is the writer, he's always referred to himself in the third person, the disciple, the other disciple, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Never "I." But now at the very end, whoever is writing the actual final draft says, "I suppose that it would be impossible to write down everything Jesus did and said, and for the world to contain the books of those writings. It's intriguing to think that John himself may be the one who wrote this final verse and who's making this disclaimer that there's more to say that he wouldn't have time to give, but it's uncharacteristic of any gospel writer to use the word I. None of the gospels have the word I in them. Well, I take that back. Luke does at the, in the beginning of his gospel. But he doesn't, none of the characters in the gospels are referred to as I. But Luke talks about how he had knowledge of the situation, so I take that back. But here, one of the characters in the gospel is apparently the author and speaks of himself in the first person only here. And thus we have the incomplete story of Jesus. Incomplete partly because no one could tell the complete story without occupying too much paper and ink and too much space in the universe for the books, but also incomplete because it's not over, because as the book of Acts shows, Jesus kept on doing the same things again after he went to heaven. He just did them through his new body, the church. And so the story of Jesus doesn't ever end at the end of the Gospels. It has not ended yet. It continues in the book of Acts. It continues beyond the book of Acts. It continues even as we speak. Jesus, through his body, is still working miracles, still giving life to those who believe in him, still present with his people. His spirit is still with us, and so that is why we still have the life that John testifies of. He says, these things are written so that you might believe and you might have life through believing. And so we do, because we have Jesus in this life, is in God's Son. He that has the Son has life. So John tells us later, in a later epistle. But we have no later for this session. This is the end of this session, and we will close the school.